Welcome to another episode of Thoughtzilla. I am your host Manish, and again we have Sai Shekhar today with us after an episode of gap. Hi Shekhar.
Hello Manish.
Yeah, so today we have with us Mr. Prabhuraj Jagirdar, who is the chairperson and founder of People Tree Group of Institutions. Welcome to our podcast, sir.
Welcome to all of you. Thanks for inviting me.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
So, sir, we just want to start out by asking you, how has this pandemic impacted the life of teachers?
This pandemic is very unique. In the last 130 years, education sector has never seen such kind of a phenomena anytime. None of us were prepared for it. Neither the school management, nor the teachers, nor the children, nor the parents of children were prepared for it. So this came very, very suddenly. March 20th, we were asked to shut down. No examinations were conducted. There was an undeclared holiday for 2 months, and none of us were prepared. So it came as a surprise, a big surprise, to especially schools and especially teachers, that they didn't know what to do, how to navigate this sudden shutdown of public institutions.
So, sir, when this pandemic hit the schools and everything, when you cannot reopen, a lot of schools started the online learning process. So, do you think online learning really can be an effective alternative?
No, first of all, I think, let me take a few steps backward. If you look around, first question which came to our mind when we realized that schools are not going to be open for a long, long time, even after lockdowns, because we realized that much earlier in the month of March or early April, that schools are going to be the last of the public institutions which are going to be open even after the lockdown, number one. Number two, so much of fear crisis, psychosis has been created amongst the parents and amongst the public, that even if it is open, unless and until parents have the confidence that their children will be safe, they will be not ready to send the children to schools, number two. Number three, how is that we have to gain the confidence, if at all the children have to come back to the schools? That is the three issues. Okay. Now, coming back to online, we realize that what will children do from now till such time people or parents feel confident to send their children to the school? This is a big question. Because learning is something, it is an ongoing process. You cannot have stops in between. It's an ongoing, continuous process. Everything in the world can stop, but learning is continuous. So the big questions which are thrown to all the educationists around the world is how, despite the pandemics, despite the constraints of physical schools not opening, and with this very idea that we're going to be the last of the institutions to be opened, how we have to continue the learning. So these are some of the issues which were faced. So I would say that teachers and educators around the world were somebody who were unsung heroes of this pandemic. They were the heroes of this pandemic. Why? The reason is very simple. When the whole world came to a grinding halt, industries, service sector, transportation sector, travel sector, most of the governments were shut down, bureaucrats were made to sit at home, courts stopped working, only few sectors were allowed to work officially. One was the health sector, other was the essential sector. But the third sector, unofficially, which never closed its shop, was the education sector. Because very quickly the schools realized that we cannot stop ourselves being close to our children. We have to find ways to continue the process of learning. We have to find means so that the process will never get interrupted just because officially, physically, the doors and the gates of the schools are closed. So this is where I come back and say our teachers or educators are unsung heroes, because despite everything shutting down around them, they quickly upskilled themselves, unlearned the old ways of doing things, relearned new ways of doing things, and ensured that they quickly climbed on to the online bandwagon and started researching, training themselves, sharing ideas of how to go about teaching, and started the classes. For example, in Pupil Tree, we started, I think 18th was the date when the schools were asked to shut down. 24th hit us that we are not going to be open for a long time. 26th, we had a meeting on the phone discussing what to do, how to go about. 26th evening, we figured out what technologies to use. 27th, training started. 28th, demo started. 29th, 30th, we did more demos. Second, we started our first class. So
that is on April 2nd.
April 2nd, we started the first class.
Okay.
Much before anybody woke up. So this is why I have coined this word unsung heroes of the pandemic.
Sir, I'm really interested in what really went in your thought process while, you know, taking this decision, you know, what went in that meeting and what was in your mind, you know, how did you come to this, you know, solution, or how was your thought process during that time? You know, can I know that?
The thought process, where you see any problems, one has to look at it very historically. If you are historically minded, then you can see every problem very deep, not just to the surface level. So when I looked around and understood how did the pandemic span out in the world in the past, 100 years ago, 200, when the great black bubonic plague took place, or prior to that, the Spanish plague took place. How did it pan out? How many years did it stay? Right? How did they start? How did they progress? How did they die? Right? Or how did they rather were controlled? Right? Then I realized quickly that there is no quick solutions to this. Then I started discussing with my staff and saying that, hey, you know what? What we have got into is not something where they're going to be easy solutions. We have to brace ourselves for long shutdowns and long lockdowns if you look around, because number one is all pandemics in this world have taken time. Number two, how many people have died because of pandemic? So many people, or more people, have died because of the effects of other effects of pandemics, whether it is economical, political, war, etc., etc. Number two. Number three is that there is no magic bullet. There is no absolutely today, as on today, there are no whatsoever remedies available, vaccine not available. When we looked around and I started looking around WHO and other websites and started talking to professionals around who are working in this industry, they told us that minimum at whatever speed any government works, minimum any remedy or any vaccine or whatever it is will take not less than 2 years, right? So then it hit on to us that what we have got into is not short term. It's not 1 month lockdown. It's not 2 months lockdown. It's going to be a long, long, long lockdown to come in. So we have to brace for it. And, opportunities always come. And you have to understand crisis. There are two ways of reacting to the crisis. One way of reacting is you deny that there is a crisis. Other way is you take it head on. So we understood that this is not going to go away, and we took it head on. But many of them are only, even till now, even after 3-4 months, are trying to deny it. They're seeing it as a short-term phenomena. They're trying to wish it away and not do anything about it. But then history has shown us that only those institutions, schools and individuals thrive who have understood and have built enough resilience, skills, knowledge to fight it out and come out strong of any crisis. So this is the transition which went through in our minds when we started making those decisions. Why do we have to get on the online very quickly?
I mean, there is this saying, sir. I mean, I've recently read it. Like, when the tough gets when the going gets tough, the tough gets going. So this is very much true for in this time, actually.
Correct.
Sir, I also want to ask you that I have come across this principle, and you also said to me that you are following this SAMR technique. So can you just tell what is this and how can schools implement it?
See, a lot of people, before we get into those acronyms and SAMR, I think you have to understand the background of online learning a little bit. See, lot of people are not understanding. This is a very new space. See, it is the online learning for majority of them people is only a space which they are kind of getting familiar with it from the last 2 to 3 months. Before that, it was there in pockets. It was there here and there. There were some companies which were working, which were trying to enter into this market, but it was very limited to that the corporate level. But at the level of schools, at the level of a teacher, at the level of a parent, it was a concept which was not very well understood. So most of the schools are very new to this concept. So how do schools react when they are forced to go online, right? So it is a very typical behavior. The way we always try to change is we always try to hold on to the familiar, right? While we try to do few things which is new. Typical behavior of humankind is that anytime we throw a change at somebody, right? So we want to hold on to what we know already, right? So majority of the people or maybe say teachers, educators started trying to replicate what they know. What does the teacher know? Typically a teacher is not trained to work online. Online is a different skill altogether. You have to unlearn whatever you know in your whatever you build last 10 years, 15 years, 20 years, whatever years you have taught, and you have to relearn a new medium. The first thing they have to understand is that it is not the you cannot replicate what you are doing in the classroom online. They're two different mediums. So, but what you do, you don't know anything. There is no roadmap for you. So, what do you end up doing? The first step towards summer model. It's called SAMR model, is substitution. So what you do is, the word substitution means you substitute what you did online, offline, online. You understand? That's the first. So what do you normally do? How does it really take shape? So you do, you're saying that you take a board, you start working on the board, you ask somebody to record it and live stream it. Typical, right? Right? The other way is that you take a book and you start writing it, you start live streaming whatever you are writing on a book, and that is kind of going all around, right? The other way is you make a video and then asynchronously you post it on Facebook or send it, make groups and send it on WhatsApp groups, right? This is essentially you are saying that I just want to recreate, right, my classroom environment online, right? So this is how everybody starts. This is how, like, even today as we are talking, 95% of the schools and the educators are in this model, the model called S, substitution model, right? Then they get into, after being familiar, they realize that what is working offline is not necessarily going to work online, because online is a different media. There are different dynamics at work. Right, it's not the same. So they, once they gain a little bit of confidence, they'll start using or trying to explore ways which they think that are going to be effective online, right? Yes. So it is called the augmentation, right? The second step is augmentation. So they start doing substitutes, right? Direct substitutes. They start substituting the old by experimenting they start simple things like sending worksheets online, right? Or they'll start using PowerPoint, right? Because they would not use PowerPoints earlier. They'll start making PowerPoints, right? So they'll start showing few videos or multimedia, right? Or some sharing of some pictures, right? So they are trying to replace or augment the traditional tools like chalk and talk or a board or this thing with some kind of digital media in bits and pieces. Okay, so this is the second step. First step is completely substituting. Second is augmenting digital resources, right? Once they play around with some of this multimedia tools, or they start playing around with making interesting slides and PPT and and stuff like that, they gain in confidence. They are not very happy with that. They want to progress further because they gained in confidence and seeing that it is making a hell of a lot of difference than what they did in the past. So they gain in confidence. And in all this, I think what is important is leadership at the top, right? It is not an automatic progression, you understand? So it's like many people are stuck in level one itself. You know, why they're stuck in level one is because there is no leadership giving them direction how to proceed, right? Pupil tree, I'll come in, coming back, we're very, very clear that we have to progress and be at the top of the game in 3 months' time, right? By end of 3 months, we should utilize online in such a way that it has to be engaging, effective, and most importantly, it has to create a difference to our children and our staff. It has to make a difference. Because we are very clear day one that online classes is not substitution. Online classes is not temporary phenomenon. Online classes is not something we'll do stopgap. We clearly on day one, in the first meeting I told, if ever we get an online, we will, when the schools open, we will not reteach, we'll only revise. No reteaching, only revising, right? So if you believe in reteaching, then you're just going to, you know, do a hand-waving job and get away. But if you believe that there is going to be only revision and you want to teach it as if this is the final, then you go out all out and ensure that you give your best and ensure that the actual learning happens, right? So many of the schools are only doing it as stopgap. They're having this very temporary mentality and they're not putting in everything in their heart and soul to make it happen. That's why online classes, many, many people are very suspicious of it, right? So now coming to the third model in the summer, SA, we finished. Now we are going to the M, right? Now what is M? In the M model, we are entering into modification, right? So what is this? What happens during this modification stage? In this modification stage, you will start understanding that you can bring in various tools to play, right? You can modify your learning. You can suit it purely, like it is the purely online learning. It has got nothing to do with what you did in the classroom. For example, there are many tools one can integrate into this stage. For for example, we are using Kahoot. Kahoot is a very interesting gaming tool which is incorporated to as a way of assessments, right? Then we have a tool called Class Dojo, which is an online classroom management tool where to involve children in the classroom because the online can be very lonely process, right? So classroom management tools enable for all the children to participate, create peer groups, right? Start doing project works together, right? Then using tools like Whiteboard FI, where a math teacher can see, the children can share their screens, the math teacher can see all children participating and solving the problem, right? Then we are using various other tools which are there, and that is one part. The second part is, you start experimenting with what digital assets children can create, right? What are the digital assets? For example, we can do flip classes, right? Children flip the classes where they come and teach, right? They teach and they become the teachers. The steering is given to them in their hands. So flip classes start working and they start doing these kind of classes where each one teach one, peer-to-peer learning happens, right? It's no more controlled, but the central figure in this period is not just the teacher. It's like social learning. Everybody's learning from the other, right? So this is a very interesting stage because suddenly they start seeing the power of what online can do, right? And they'll see that online is not a very limiting factor. There are million things one we can achieve and they'll feel more and more encouraged to keep on introducing newer tools so that the learning is happening at different nodes. It's the knowledge is not flowing one way, right? So knowledge is flowing from different directions. So it becomes a kind of a community in this group, right? And the fourth phase is the final phase where it becomes truly, truly, truly engaging and truly effective. That stage is called redefinition, right? In redefinition, what happens is you redefine the entire process. You no more are carrying the baggage of your offline learning into this, right? You create a community, right? You realize that already, like, I am collaborating. We are forming teams and making groups. We are using various tools like polling or quizzing or watching videos together or critiquing a poem or an author together or reviewing a book or doing group assignments, stuff like that. And then you realize that why are we just stopping it, the learning within the confines of our own group? Actually, you can throw it out to the whole world, right? Why can't the whole world become a classroom? You understand? You actually, there's so much resources out there. You can bring in various expertise into your classroom while you are there, right? So at this stage, partly we already reached there in some of these classes in Pupil Tree. For example, our children, when they are studying about they're studying about certain diseases, right? So last Saturday we had a webinar with a research scientist based in Germany who is doing cutting edge research on cancer research, right? So previous to that, they were trying to learn a very difficult Kabir Ke Dohe in Hindi. You know, in Hindi, it's difficult to teach Kabir Ke Dohe unless and until you have good expertise and strong language. In all said and done, we are South Indians and our teachers have only functional knowledge of Hindi, not deep language. So we tapped in one Hindi Pandit who's sitting all the way in Uttarakhand, right? And who could come and explain this Dohe so beautifully, it chased Hindi, so much of depth and vocabulary and stuff like that. It kind of, otherwise in a regular class, we wouldn't have had this expertise. Imagine trying to fly somebody in just into Ballari or get somebody in the train to just teach Kabir Ke Dohe with just a small para, right? So similarly, we had interactions like our children were learning in EVA class. They were learning about, sustainable agriculture, right? So we interacted with a farmer who took in Chitradurga and Angeri between that. He took us around his farm, spoke about organic farming, spoke about what are the challenges involved in it, right? So similarly, we are interacting with health professionals, we are interacting with scientists. In fact, we also invited some of the authors and writers, into the classroom to come and talk to us about the process of writing, the process of critiquing, the enjoying the language, whether it's Hindi, Kannada, and Tamil. And also we invited some theater professionals, storytellers, right? Various people started coming into your classroom as if, this is like an open classroom. Anybody can drop in anytime. So this is the power of online learning. You understand? So that summer stage is very important. Most of them are stuck in stage one. That is substitution, but you have to progress. Unless and until you progress, this world can be very limiting, very frustrating, because what at the end of 1 month, a teacher will start feeling very, 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 very constrained, and the children will get very, very stressed, because most often teachers don't switch on their videos. Most often children don't switch on their videos or interact or ask any questions. It will be a monotonous monologue. Teacher will come, teacher will speak, children will listen only one way, only one of your senses will be involved, that is listening senses. And it is going to be a very monotonous voice, monotonous learning. People will get fatigued and they will very quickly lose interest in online learning. That is what is happening in many schools now.
When you are a management student, it's always said to you that change always comes with resistance. So when this, when you were trying to make this change at Pupil Tree, how did you encounter resistance, and why was Pupil Tree able to adapt to this change very quickly?
So you have to understand that the anatomy of change, right? What is change? Is there, and how we have to deal with change? I think we have to understand as leaders in the 21st century, whether you're a leader at a school, whether you're a leader of a small shop, which you're owning a small entrepreneur or a proprietor, or whether you're running a multi-billion dollar company. One thing today's constant is, you have to, any leader who does not know how to manage change will be ineffective. Any leader who does not know how to lead change will be very ineffective. The reason being that everything is today changing at the speed of light, right? So we as human beings, when you look around, we love doing both things. One is we love familiarity, we love predictability, we love our routines, right? We want to hold on to what we know already. The other end, the same human being wants to look for a better way of living, better way of doing, better understanding, and is always curious to understand the unknown. So there is a battle always going on within ourselves, holding on to the past, touching the future, living yesterday, thinking about tomorrow, living in the present. So there is this constant dynamics at work. So a good leader is the one who can strike a balance, right? Not everything we know in the past is waste. What we have experienced is our wisdom. How we use our wisdom, at the same time, use that wisdom to move through the uncharted territory is where the game lies in, right? So if you look around pupil tree, from day one, we have realized that we are living in the 21st century. 21st century means, the other word means constant change, both within our borders, outside our borders, within our education field, in technology field, in markets, everywhere things are changing. Unless and until we continuously adapt, also ensure that we are keeping our ears to the ground, we will fail as an institution. So we, 20 years ago, when we created this organization, we are very clear in our mind that we should be a very change-oriented organization. We should be leaders and pioneers in whatever we do. We should build an organization in such a way that we are open to learn. We are bold and we are not risk averse. We are ready to take any risk. And we create structures within the organization where there is absolutely no resistance to change, where everybody loves to do new things, everybody is celebrating new things, everybody wants to enjoy new things. Because if you see, we are not a tech company. We are a school, and schools are very notorious for ensuring that nothing changes. Because they hold on to their past, they hold on to their glory, they hold on to what they know, because they're all about routines. Schools are all about reputation and routines, right? So the change comes the last two schools. But however, we ensure that even if you are a school, so what? We should always ensure that whatever, we keep our ears and eyes open and ensure that our teachers are risk-taking. They do not mind doing new things. While we celebrate what we did well, we always look out what can we do better next time. See, this is thinking which is very important. So this is already there in the institution. The question, to answer your question, this culture already existed in the institution, right? Now, when the opportunity came, we were ready for it. So it was not a big deal. Did I tell you the whole sequence that in 3-4 days, we're up and running? In 3-4 days, our teachers were up and running. So that's because when I look back and say, when all the other schools and colleges are struggling, why we did things so seamlessly? When I asked this question to my own leaders, school leaders and teachers, they were saying, sir, but this is what we are all prepared for. This is something not new for us. This is how we were built. This is the answers I got from our own teachers. When I asked them how your other colleagues in other schools are dealing with, what struggles they're having, they said, sir, first of all, they lack leadership, they lack vision, they're so much comfortable doing what they did in the past, they're afraid to adapt to new situations, nobody's there to guide them. And there are a lot of issues of technology and fear of technology and stuff like that. So that is why they're struggling. But we found it very, very seamless here because we were built that way.
So, sir, your PupilTree has been doing this online learning for 3 months now.
Yes.
So do you think there is this potential for online learning to become a mainstream medium?
See, the way to answer it, that online, there are certain constraints of online learning, right? I believe that every learning in the world, or I would say that all meaningful learning in the world is social. You can learn facts and figures online. What are we teaching kids? Facts and theorems. We are teaching math. We are teaching concepts. We are teaching theory, right? These are facts. These are these are very objective facts. What you can touch, smell, and smell, and hold, and measure, and count, and weigh, right? These are easy things. Or you can use also, you know, you can go up on the YouTube and learn how to bake a cake, right? Or you can go on YouTube and learn French or maybe German or Spanish, right? But is that really learning? I don't think so. That is only transitioning, right? Transacting, not transitioning. Transacting of information, transacting of data, transacting of just facts and figures and some knowledge, right? True learning happens when there is a process of change within us. There is a transformation of a human being, right? That is true learning. So I don't think so online can ever transform anybody. Transformation happens when we are in a social context. When I see my father acting and reacting in a certain way in every situation comes his way. I see my mother walking gracefully and dealing with life with so much of joy and objectivity. I see my friend being along with me and trying to tell me how to live a life without much hang-ups. I see how my teachers are dealing with various problems, how they are ethically or unethically or emotionally or objectively or rationally, how they are reacting to ongoing situations around them, right? So all this, I feel, is not possible online. Because true learning to me is a very social process. Human beings learn from another human being. So this is one of the greatest limiting factors. So online cannot replace face-to-face learning. It can only be a tool, like many tools, like a chalk and like a chalk or a board or a computer or a laptop, right? They are just tools, but it cannot replace a human being. It cannot replace a teacher. No way it can replace a teacher. So I just wrote a quote very recently on my Facebook wall. I said that technology cannot replace teachers, but teacher who uses technology can replace a teacher who doesn't.
Thank you, sir, for being on our podcast. It has been lovely having you here, and you have definitely changed my views on online learning. So I hope it happens same to the listeners as well.
Yes, sir. I mean, I was not really aware of this summer model. You know, it really opened up a different perspective, you know, like getting different experts to students, you know, at a very effective pace, but still learning at the greatest level is a really a different thinking. I must say, sir, I'm really moved by this. Thank you, sir. Thank you for being on the show.
Thank you for inviting me.